critical, as we learn when we climb aboard the Sierra for a high-speed and adventurous trip through Donegal. 50,
John.
With that slight mistake behind us, Bertie must now get down to work, as on his tail is the current Dutch and Irish tarmac champion, Englishman Mark Lovell, driving the Gemini Works Sierra Cosworth. A rally professional determined to do a professional job in Donegal. Alongside him, somebody who has tasted victory twice before in Donegal, Terry Harriman. Third on the road is Circuit of Ireland runner-up Phil Collins, again in a Group A Sierra. But Phil will not remain in the pink for long on this event. By stage six, he is out, and Phil tells his own sad tale.
We came across the crossroads just down there, and very fast crossroads with a left-hander just after it. Quite a lot of gravel on the exit, and I think maybe the tail end was there a little bit there. And then just 70 yards after, there was a long right, which was not that sharp, but just uphill, and for some reason the back end just broke away. I thought I'd caught it, and then the back end clipped the bank, and we just rolled onto our side and then back on our wheels. So it was nothing more serious than that. The damage to the car isn't that bad, actually, but the steering's broke. The steering arm is broken on the left-hand side, and that was why we were stuck in the road for a few minutes. So that was a bit unfortunate. I think we were lying in third place, but just a few seconds off Mark and James. There was just nothing in it. So, we're a little disappointed, to say the least.
Also disappointed is Donegal's top seed, James Cullen, who has lost a minute and a half when Phil blocked the road. This is a do-or-die effort for Cullen and co-driver Ellen Morgan in their eight-year-old Ascona. The delay is shattering, for they have been putting considerable pressure on Lovell. The same fate befell the other Donegal favourites, Vincent Bonner and Rory Kennedy, who dropped to sixth. Not as drastic, however, as James McDade, who is already out, and Austin McHale, who didn't start due to illness. Mike Patterson's unusual 2-litre heart-engine Sierra has already had a gearbox change in Rafaux service, but he will finish the day in ninth place, one place ahead of Kenny Colbert's Nissan-engined rear-wheel drive Peugeot. Intercom problems between Kenny and co-driver have affected this car. And Alan Johnson and Paul Kiley have also had problems with the electrics of their Lotus Sunbeam. Pat Kirk, with Kevin Shaw aboard, is getting used to his hired Manta 400. The Strabane garage owner is already seventh. And lying in an excellent third place behind Lovell and Fisher is Stephen Emerson and Mervyn McClelland in their Nissan Peugeot. But watch John Galise and Stephen Boswell disappear for the last time. Stage three is their downfall. Jerry McVeigh is seventh after three stages, but he will receive a 10-minute penalty for service infringements. And here's that giant-killing John Lyons in the Group N Showroom Lancia Delta. He's in eighth place after six stages, which defies description, but Derek Porter's stage descriptions must be helping. Michael Barable and Dermot O'Rourke are getting quicker with each event. The Dublin pairing are now in fourth place. Sadly, though, Frank Fennell and George Miller will not complete the first day. That flat-sounding Group A cadet is about to retire with valve trouble. And here's the Lancia chaser in Group N, Cyril Bolton and Derek Irvine's Cosworth Sierra. For the Englishman, Group N is a new experience, and 11th overall is very respectable.
Long crest, 70 crest.
Back on board the second-placed Alamax Sierra, Austin Fraser, a twice winner and former clerk of the course in Donegal, calls the pace notes for our adventure through the Rafaux byroads.
200, long crest, a white wall. 100, double caution, jump into fast left. And right, and square right. And very fast left, into turn, herp and right. 50 crest, 50 easy left, 50 turn left max, and right over crest.
Fisher is settling in well, but Lovell is 29 seconds ahead by the end of the first day. The majestic Muckish Mountain beckons the survivors for the big day. Saturday is the real test with 14 of the 26 stages. All are classics like Glen, Hornhead, Atlantic Drive, Kindrum Lake, and the frightening Knockalla. For Mark Lovell, Donegal is an all-new experience, but the experienced Terry Harriman knows all the tricks, and the combination of both talents are working well.
Well, it's been going okay against Bertie. On the first stage, we took about 14 seconds off him, and the second, a couple. I don't know what happens on the last one, but James Cullen's going very quickly. I think he should be up to third by now. He was 10 seconds quicker than us on the second stage today, but we took a fair bit out of him on the first stage, so it's about all square, I think, at the moment.
As Fisher comes through, Cullen is indeed the name on everybody's lips. Secretly, Bertie concedes that Mark's turbo techniques seem to be superior, but for the present, he is holding the Englishman.
Oh, we're just holding station at the moment, anyway. Mark's been taking a few seconds of stage from us, each stage this morning. But we're happy enough. James Collins obviously going very, very quickly. But I suppose a lot depends on the outcome of his appeal, you know.
Appeal or not, Cullen is catching Emerson, whose great showing is about to hit trouble. Michael Barrable and Dermot O'Rourke have already lost fourth place to the advancing Donegal man, but the ex-racing driver is still impressive. And here comes our hero, physically launching the Better Blinds and Tony Kelly Cars sponsored Ascona at the Donegal countryside. A performance that's not without its pain.
I hurt your arm way back a long time ago, a few months back, you know, and was just with the heavy steering and maybe trying a bit too hard. The muscles have got very, very sore again, you know.
It hasn't slowed you down this morning?
It has this morning in the first stage. I found it very, very difficult in the first stage this morning. We've really had to try very hard to overcome the pain of it, just, you know, and try and keep going. But apart from that, now we've got the magic rub here now, we're away.
The touch.
Vincent Bonner's Donegal Oil Company-sponsored Manta is also advancing, and he has got ahead of Barrable. But the former winner is also having his minor problems.
On first stage this morning, coming out, just about maybe a quarter of a mile into it, we clipped a stone. We didn't realise, you know, that we'd done any damage. We just happened to notice the tyre there now.
Was it going down on you?
No, it wasn't, but the side of the tyre's cracked, which we didn't realise till now just. And just a precautionary measure to change it, you know.
Pat Kirk's times are improving by the mile as he gets used to the Phil Collins loaned Manta. Sadly, however, this is the last time we will see John Lyons and the Lancia. The engine has had it, and the Belfast bank official is about to experience his first ever Donegal retirement. The tranquility on Hornhead is shattered by a hovering spectator who heralds the arrival of the rally leader. Lovell seems to want to join the chopper in the sky, and he is learning that professionals can easily be humbled by amateurs over this terrain. The locals are closing in. Bertie Fisher's similar Gemini Sierra has closed the gap by 6 seconds, bringing him back to just 37 seconds behind his look-alike leader. But all are now worried about James Cullen, who has moved up to third, only 48 seconds behind the second-place Sierra. His appeal against yesterday's delay has been thrown out, and this seems to spur him on to even greater feats. Vincent Bonner would like to have stronger front springs on the Manta for this type of aviating, but service time doesn't allow it. He is now fourth, 29 seconds behind Cullen.
Go,
Both, however, have benefited from Stephen Emerson's problems, who has dropped to sixth place. Once going, the Nissan Peugeot is as spectacular as ever, but a bell housing has cracked and he will soon be out. To be sponsored by the airport driving school seems appropriate on these roads. Michael Barrable is another to have moved ahead of the ailing Emerson. He now lies fifth, but he will crash out sadly on Knockalla. And Pat Kirk will move up by the time we next see him. For Pat, Donegal is an annual outing, and the change from his normal Nissan 240 RS to the Manta is proving highly satisfactory. Despite hitting a rock and bending two rims on Atlantic Drive, Mike Patterson maintains his eighth position. The wide-booted, ears-sponsored Sierra uses all the road. Kenny Colbert, who leads the Anglo-Irish Bancor National Rally Championship, is in ninth place in his unique Peugeot-based car that he and Sidney Meek have created. While Ian Calvert and brother Ewell complete the top 10 in another rear-wheel drive Peugeot. This one has been built by the two brothers and houses an Opel 400 engine with spectacular results. Back at Milford Service, Bertie Fisher has hit a major problem.
We had a clutch problem for Hornhead and Atlantic Drive. And then we came into service and the boys had to change the clutch because it wouldn't have went very much further. So it took more than the time allowed in service to do the job. We dropped 5 minutes going out of service, which is 50 seconds road penalties. So it's dropped us to third place now.
Disappointed about that?
Well, not really, you know, it's one of those harder rallying. James Cullen was going very quickly, he was probably going to overtake us anyway, so we're not really too disappointed.
Is the car sorted now?
Yes, hopefully it'll be sorted now. It certainly was okay, we were quickest over Knockalla there, so it must be near enough.
Fisher's problems promote James Cullen to second, and Donegal is going wild with excitement. But James, unfortunately, has his own worries.
We had a bit of a serious problem at on the end of Hornhead. We came across the finish line and the oil light came on and we had no oil pressure. And we had to drive another 6 miles into service before we could fix it. So it says a lot for the Gemini oil when we drove 6 miles, no oil pressure, and we're still going.
Is it a serious problem or can you sort it out?
We have it sorted out. We fitted a new oil pump belt in, you know, but it's a bit of a miracle. I think the car went that far with, on no oil pressure, you know.
All, including co-driver Ellen Morgan, are impressed by Cullen's driving.
I was nearly speechless at the end of Knockalla. I think that's the fastest I've been driven on tarmac by anybody. That was just incredible.
Bertie Fisher is now running late on the Fannett stages.
100 long left, maybe. 70 easy right. And crest. 50 left over crest.
He charges along the Kindrum Lake test, down amongst the lower numbers, which can bring its own problems.
50 caution, very fast left of 3, and right max. Watch it, watch it.
That wreckage is Keith Horseman's Manta 400. He and Chris Jones are unhurt, but the Manta is badly damaged, and amazingly, they will make it to Milford service, where the shaken Englishman recalls his frightening moment.
I thought that I heard the note as one left, which is a very, very fast left, but when we got there, it was in fact a very tight left. So it was a big brake job, but unfortunately we just couldn't stop it and tried to throw the car in, wouldn't have it, and it was very fortunate that the bank was extremely soft. So I think we shifted about 3 yards of earth, but eventually, you know, after hitting it, it threw us onto the side and blocked the stage. We got out very quickly, kicked the screen out, and managed to push the car back into the bank to at least allow the stage to carry on, and nobody really lost too much time through it.
Ian, yes.
Yeah. Circles in the sand spell out support for Vincent Bonner on the breathtaking Knockalla Beach. From a mountain top in the Kingdom of Fannet, we look down on the hill climb course, used many times in the past by the Donegal Motor Club. Knockalla stage goes into the rally manual, along with the Torini Pass in France, Sintra in Portugal, Kielder in England, as one of the world's great stages. And Mark Lovell, who's experiencing it for the first time this year, drives it like a veteran. Lovell will end the day 1 minute 54 seconds ahead of Cullen. But Saturday has been a good day for James, from fifth to second in 14 stages. Not so for Fisher, who is now 1 minute 5 seconds behind the Ascona. And Bonner in fourth place is becoming a threat, as he is less than a minute adrift. But the Dunlow man complains of a fluffy engine. Pat Kirk has moved ahead of Patterson to come home at the end of the second day in fifth position. The rally now moves into new territory, close to Ireland's largest fishing port, Killybegs. For a local family, it's an opportunity to make the most of a sunny Sunday. But it's not plain sailing, however, for the leader, as the rear axle in the Gordon Spooner-prepared Sierra is making a horrible noise. It is the first big worry in a flawless weekend, but the offending part will be changed within the time limit at the next service. James Cullen and Ellen Morgan never give up. Their oil light worry, fortunately, only proved to be a faulty wire. But try as they might, they have to settle for second. It's been a drive that has shown Cullen's true brilliance, but sadly his future in rallying now depends on additional financial support if this young Irish driver is to develop his undoubted talent. Third place is still undecided. Fisher and Fraser are now in the countryside that Bonner revels in, and the Manta is closing. Nine seconds is far from a comfortable margin, and the Fermanagh crew must keep the pressure on right to the finish. Bonner and Kennedy in fourth place have plenty of local support, but the 83 winner is losing the power game. Pat Kirk is over 2 minutes in arrears, but secure in fifth place. And then come the class winners. Cyril Bolton and Derek Irvine taking the Group N honours, from Leo Shaw and Seamus Boyle in their similar car. Welshman John Roberts has the 1600 class in Group N. And Ken Irwin the 2 litre category. John McGlinchey is the 1300 Group N class winner, and in Group A, Seamus Carey is the 1300 winner, Richard Smith the 1600 winner, and Joe and Dermot McHugh take class 11 and 12th place overall. Louise Nolan and Janice Mackerel win the ladies' award on their first outing in the Lancia Delta Integrale. The Emerald Band, dressed in blue, bring the Shell Gemini Donegal International Rally to a close. And they lead Mark Lovell to the victory ramp for the second time in Ireland this year. It's indeed happiness in the hills for Mark and Terry Harriman, and Ford's third tarmac win in a row, but it's not been easy.
It's been one of the hardest rallies that I've ever had to do. It's fantastic, the roads are very fast. Thankfully it stayed dry, so that was a bit of a help for us, really.
And what about the Donegal stages? Did you enjoy them?
Yeah, incredible, really fantastic. I mean, they must be the fastest tarmac stages in the world, I would think. I've never driven on roads so fast. And that really is a big challenge for us. So it was a real experience. I'm really chuffed to come out with a win.
Well, you've got a win first time out, but it's that's not a new experience for you, Terry. Third time victory in Donegal, I believe.
Yes, Donegal's been very... I've always liked Donegal, and it seems to like me. It's the third win. Seven outings, three wins and 2 seconds.
Not a bad record. Yeah. How does this one compare with the other two victories?
Just as good. Just as good. Maybe more satisfying at my time of life.
And the champagne's going to taste just as sweet?
Better.
The professionals have won the day, and the vast crowds in Letterkenny have two heroes. If is a big word in rallying, but if the Friday hold-ups had not occurred, anyway, James is pleased to be home.
It's really super coming back into one's own hometown and seeing all these people here rooting for you, you know, and it's made a big difference all weekend, especially after the first day. It was a bit disappointing.
Do you notice things like that whenever you're on the stages? I mean, can you hear the people cheering you on?
Today you could hear them and you could see them coming out and the hands up, and it was really, it just helps motivate you, of course, like, because, but it's been a good rally and it's been really well organised, and it's just typical Donegal rally, the best.
Bertie Fisher and Austin Fraser are no doubt remembering their glories of last year. Victory is not theirs this time, but third place has brought to an end Bertie's run of bad luck in 1988.
Oh, it's been a fantastic rally. Again, the organisation of the rally has been really first class. There hasn't been any problems. Stages have all run, and again, they've been very good stages, all the classic stages in Donegal. And I think, as Mark Lovell said earlier, this is one of the best places probably in the world for good, hard, tough rallies. And the dry conditions this weekend, I think, made it even tougher on both the men and the machinery. So.
And third place in the Sierra, I mean, you must be fairly pleased with that.
Yes, I am pleased. The Sierra is quite a different car than the cars I've been driving in the past. Being turbocharged, it takes a different technique. I have been having finding difficulty over the last few events coming to terms with it. And this is only my second tarmac event in the car, but it certainly has been worthwhile. I've gained a lot of experience with the car.
So once again, the Donegal Motor Club have come up with a winning event, and once again, Mark Lovell has proved that he and the Sierra are a hard combination to beat in Ireland.